Let's start the recordings. Oh, it started. now we will start a second talk of part six of ICU Linguistic Colloquium on African Linguistics. Let me introduce the second speaker, Cédric Patin is Maître de Conference in Linguistics at the University of Lille in France. His research interests include, but not limited to, prosody, phonology, syntax interface, tone, intonation, and especially Bantu languages, and work on Shingazidja that he will share here. He also has interest in some French language research. Cédric, in fact, had an opportunity to visit ICU a few years ago, and he shared actually his research and also interacted with the French learning students at the time and also with the French department. So that was really great. And yeah, I knew Cédric forever, like since my graduate school year. So without further ado, please go ahead. Like, welcome at ICULINC. And he will talk about tone, stress, and vowel sonority interaction in Shingazidja.
Thank you, Seunghun. I will now share my screen. So thank you, Seunghun, and thank you the team for inviting me to participate in this online colloquium. I will discuss in this talk the notion of tone loss. You know that almost all of Niger-Congo languages are tonal, and that Proto-Niger-Congo was tonal, but many languages have lost their tones. Not many when considering the whole family, but many languages in the eastern part or in the northern part of the phylum. The most known example probably is Kiswahili. And in some cases, we can consider that the contact with non-tonal languages was involved in the loss of the tone. So it's a case for Atlantic languages, for instance, and maybe in cases like Swahili or Shingazidja, Arabic or French played a role, but we don't know exactly what happened and how it happened. And sometimes, and most of the time, it's discussed only along the lexical aspects and the contrastive aspects. So in this talk, I will discuss a bit tone loss in Shingazidja, an ongoing process of tone loss. And we don't know, as I said, many things on this subject. And I will focus in the second part of the talk on the relationship that tone, stress, and sonority have in Shingazidja, which is quite complex and may explain how the tone changed to an accentual language. Some background on Shingazidja. So it's a Bantu language spoken in Grand Comore or Comoros. It's one of the five Comorian languages. The data were mostly recorded when my main informant was in La Réunion, so it was with Skype, but the first part will discuss examples I gathered many years ago. I will just give you some elements on Shingazidja. So it's a language with nominal classes, like Jochen talked about before. It was at one time considered a dialect of Kiswahili, but it's not the case anymore. And because of colonization, there was a large part of the lexicon that comes from Arabic or French origin. And there is an augment, Jochen talked about pre-prefix before, it's almost the same, except that in Shingazidja, it has really the same behavior almost as definite articles in Romance languages. So Shingazidja is quite specific in Bantu on this aspect. Just a short information on consonants. You can see the table here. What is interesting is the fact that you have implosives and some postalveolar and dental consonants. And basically, in the lexicon, the dental consonants are associated to Arabic or French loans, while the retroflex or implosives are associated with Bantu lexical. There are some phenomena that I will not focus about, like hardening, and Shingazidja is also one of the languages that have the so-called Kwanyamalo. I can talk about it after the talk if you're interested. More important for my purpose today, the vowels. So Shingazidja has five phonemic vowels. It's quite a classical system with two closed vowels, E and U, and two mid vowels, A and O, and one open vowel, A. You can have in some aspects of the lexicon some nasal vowels, but it will not be important for our purpose today because it's quite restricted. I will skip this one. Something which is important, but we will see later, that I will have to reconsider this issue. Bantu languages mostly have, especially in the eastern part, stress that falls on the penult. And it's also the case in Shingazidja. So you have two examples here, Janze, where you clearly see that the penult syllable is way more intense and way more longer than the final syllable. And it's also the case for Nazi, coconut, even if the tone is on the second vowel here.
Janze.
Okay. Short information on the intonation. You have several, of course, prosodic groups. What is important for us is the fact that in the end of the sentence or the utterance, you will have a final lowering because of a low Bundari tone. You can have a high Bundari tone when it's a non-final intonational phrase, but it won't be relevant for today. Okay. Let me start with the status of tones, accents, and stress in Shingazidja. And it's not clear, and I can illustrate the fact that it's not clear with these two quotes, one from Gerard Philipson and one from Chuck Kissebers. And so the one from Philipson is French, but it's quite easy to read. And what is important here is that Philipson says that clearly Comorian, and Shingazidja is one of the Comorian languages, is to consider as an accentual language, why it's not the case for other languages. And Chuck considers that Shingazidja retained the system of tonal contrast on a complex surface tonal pattern. We will see later what it means. And so you may wonder how these two giants of tones analysis can have these two different perspectives on a single language. And for first thing to say is that determining if you have accentual or tonal system is not that easy, and we will see that it's the case in Shingazidja. It's not easy in general. For many languages, it's not clear. You all know Japanese. You know that for some searchers, Japanese is not an accentual language. For somebody like Larry Hyman, it will be clearly a tonal language. So it's not always easy to decide. And especially in Shingazidja, we will see that the system has some properties that brings the language to the tonal languages and some properties that bring the language to the accentual languages. Let me give you some examples. Sorry, I have to look the hour. There are some morphemes that differ from each other only by tone. So you have some example here. For example, if I have the first person for the perfective conjugations, it will be ha, but you, which is not associated to a tone, and for is associated to a tone. It's one of the examples. You have other examples on this slide. And just To clarify, Shingazidja is one of these languages where you have an opposition between high tones and nothing. So it's not a two-tone language at the phonological level. And the fact that you have this opposition for some morphemes qualify Shingazidja as a tone language, according to Hyman, who is the main reference for the typologies in this case. And Hyman says that a language with tone is one in which an indication of pitch enters into the lexical realization of at least some morphemes. So it's quite, it's a more radical point of view than what is usually said, but it's it qualifies, as I said, Shingazidja as a tonal language. And there are other properties that also associate Shingazidja as a tone language. As Chuck said before, Shingazidja has a complex tone system. And what makes its complexity is the fact that it has an unbounded tone shift, meaning that the tone shifts as much as it can to its right, up to the time it will be blocked by another tone. So you have examples here in four. It will be more clear, I hope. You see that Walevi, drunkards, has a high tone on its final syllable when spoken in isolation. But if you say three drunkards, you will not have Walevi Wararu as expected, but you will have Walevi Wararu. The tone of the final syllable of the noun shifts to the right, and it's blocked by an underlying tone, which will be deleted. But if it's not the second syllable after the high tone, which has a high tone, if it's the following one, then it will shift from two syllables. And we'll see later that it can shift way more longer in Shingazidja. Sorry. So as I said before, when a tone shifts to a syllable, it's blocked by the following syllable if it has a tone, but the tone of the following syllable will be deleted. So here you can compare five and six. Iso two drunkards, awono walevi, waili. So you have the tone of the verb that shifts to its right up to the penult of drunkard, and the tone of drunkard that we saw before is usually expressed will be deleted, and the tone of the adjective two will be expressed. But if you have two underlying tone on the noun, as in mipira, you will have the tone of the verb that shifts to the first syllable, the second one will be deleted, then the following one will be able to express, but shift up to the penult of the adjective, and the tone of the adjective will then be deleted. So as you see, Shingazidja has a long distance tone shift, and it's quite impossible to have a stress system with just a phenomenon. In any case, I am not aware of the existence of any accentual or stress system where you can have this kind of phenomenon. It's typical of tone systems. There are also effects linked to to syntax, but I won't address these issues today. Another thing that is more typical of tone systems than of accentual system is the fact that you can have several tones on a single word, both at the underlying level and at the surface level. In eight, for instance, you have the word for umbrella, which has a high tone on the first syllable, moi, an underlying high tone on the penult, vous, which is deleted, and another tone on the final syllable, which is expressed. And as you can see here, and it's especially true for the verbal forms, you can have many tones on a single word. And once again, it's not typical of accentual systems, even if in this case, it's a bit more complicated. You can have some languages where it is possible, especially language like Tupik or this kind of stuff. On the other hand, Shingazidja has some features or behaviors that are typical of accentual languages. For instance, as you can see in 10, when a noun has one underlying tone, two underlying tones, or known underlying tones, in each case, you will have only in surface one tone on the penult. So here it's expected. As you can see, the tone does not shift onto the final syllable. It's quite classical. It's called non-finality. Also expected here for a word like banana, you expect to have the high tone and the second one is deleted. So it's not a surprise to have a high tone here. More surprising is the second line where you have a high tone even if there is no underlying tone. So what happens is the fact that you cannot have a word with no high tone. I will refine this later. And something is inserted in this case. I will explain what it is, but it's typical of accentual language to does not allow the possibility to have a non-accentual word. Another argument is the fact that monosyllabic words are whole high tone with a lexical high tone. Otherwise, they are criticized to the following words. And these elements, again, brings Shingazidja to what are typical stress accent systems according to Ayman, the fact that obligatoriness, you have to have prominence on a word that distinguishes the syllable from the others, and culminativity that every lexical word has as most one syllable mark for the highest degree of prominence. We saw before the fact that words can have several tones, but I will come back to this at another moment. Also typical of accentual language, the presence of a tone can block the deletion or the gliding of a vowel, but I will come back to this later. So for instance, in this language, when the final syllable is not high tone, and after, especially after a fricative, the vowel can be deleted. So for instance, here, lepaha, the cat, you will have lepa with a final vowel, which is deleted. While when there is a high tone on the final syllable, like in Nepache, the pen, then in this case, the vowel will be maintained. So it's more of an accentual language as a tone language. In a tone language, a typical tone language, you will expect that the tone either go back to the preceding vowel or something similar, but not maintaining the presence of the vowel to be expressed. One or two last examples for this section. The tone can strengthen the rhotic, so a consonant. Again, it's not typical of tonal languages, as you can see in these examples. When the high tone is on the penult, then the rhotic will emerge as a vibrant. You will have something like rangi. But when you have the high tone on the final vowel, in this case, you will have some lowering, some kind of weak, the consonant will be weaker, realized either as a flap or even a sibilant. So we can wonder if Shingazidja then is a tonal language, an accentual language, or a kind of mixed system. So there are some languages that have both the properties, but it's not really the case in Shingazidja. It's not like you're mixing an accentual system with a tone system. So it's not like what Ayman explained in some of his works, language that have both tone and stress accent. It's not the case here. We have the stress that I talked before, the fact that the penalty is stronger, is more intense, more long, but it's not like there are two systems that coexist. It's like it's a system that has properties of both tonal and accentual typical languages properties. Additionally, something interesting in Shingazidja is the fact that the tone system seems to evolve, the tone or the accentual system seems to evolve towards accentual properties. So I will give you just briefly two or three rules that illustrate the fact that the system is changing at the post-lexical level, and I will go back to tone stress and sonority interactions in the second part of the talk. So remember that before I explained that some words do not have tones at the underlying level, but that they will receive a prominence at the post-lexical level when they will be pronounced. So for instance, the word for a person, ndu, if it is pronounced in isolation, it will be ndu, with a clear prominence on the first syllable. But it will be true at some particular prosodic levels. And in the conservative dialects, as the dialects spoken in the north, I still don't know if it's dialects, but when people come from the north, it will be their properties. In this case, you can see that there is no underlying tone because the tone can shift through a word like wandu and up to a following word. So in 17 here, you have tinika wandu mapesa, where you have the tone of the verb that shifts up to the object money, the first syllable, the prefix, through the word wandu. And if you take a look at the pitch track, you see that clearly the high tone is on the ma here and on the sa, but there is nothing on wandu that is high in this case. But if you compare with another variety, with a speaker who comes from Moroni, the more central city in the island, you see that in this case, you have the same phenomenon as far as tone are involved. The tone shifts from the verb up to the object money. It will stop also on ma, and you also see a high tone on the final syllable, even if it's, in this case, it's lowered by the final lowering. But you see that there is a clear difference on the word for person here in singular. In this case, you see that the pitch will rise on the penult of this word. And you have to compare these situations with examples such as 19. So in this example, we have an underlying tone here. So it's expected that the tone of the verb stops in this case, but you see that in this situation, mapesa is totally different. Before it was mapesa, while in this case it's mapesa. You see that on ma, the pitch track falls, sa is totally devoiced, and you have a high tone that is downstepped for many reasons in this situation. So it means that in this case, it is clear that there is no high tone here. It's really different. However, you still have a rising of the pitch in this situation. So you see that some varieties, so the central varieties most of them, you cannot have words. In fact, it's a minor fee, but it's not important here. You cannot have a word that is not high tone. So it's a sign that words tend to evolve towards an accentual system. Another indication that you have an evolution towards a change in the system is illustrated here. So here is a typical realization of a sentence in Washili of Zinyamazili. And Zinyama is also lacks a high tone at the underlying level. And so you only have the final tone of the adjective. But you can have in another variety a high tone that emerges on the penult. And in this situation, it cannot be explained by the fact that you do not have a high tone here. What you have is a selection of the halomorph with an underlying high tone that will shift up to the adjective. And why it is the case, I have many more examples that show that the language wants the tones to be aligned with the penult or sometimes the antepenult, but the penult, which is, you remind the stressed syllable. So there are many examples that demonstrate that. I won't discuss all of them, just a last one before turning to the second part. You can also delete some tones to avoid the alignment of tones to not to the final position of words, but I won't discuss this case here, it's too complicated. Okay, so let me just summarize what I just said in this first part. So Shingazidja has some tonal properties, so like the long distance shift of tones, that clearly is something that tone language have. You also have accentual properties, so that the fact that you cannot have a word in some varieties at least that does not have a prominence, or the segment strengthening that we discussed before. And we have clues on the fact that Shingazidja is evolving towards a more prototypical action tool system than the tone system. And in the second part, we'll see that it's clearly the case. And what triggers this change is not only a kind of neutralization between at the post-lexical level, but you also have a change in the way tones are expressed. And to see this, you have to consider three elements: tones, the stress that I discussed before that falls on the penult, and the sonority of vowels. It's quite complicated. To see this, I have to consider several situations in a row. The first situation is when the accent, the stress and the tone align. So it's not accent, it's stress. So let me give you an example. Janze, we saw this example before. In this situation, you have the penult stress, the stress which falls on the penult, we saw that. And the high tone also is on the penult. In this situation, clearly the penultimate syllable, I will only consider disyllable examples for the moment. In the penult syllable, it's way more intense and way more long than the final syllable, where the vowel is almost absent, like in many stress accent systems. So let's hear again the sound.
Janzi.
So it's always the case when you align the tone with the penult, which is stressed. I give you here some example, like Tsambu.
Tsambu.
So you can hear that it's way longer, way more intense, etc. And so I won't play, of course, all the examples, but you see that it's quite regular. But now what happens when the tone is not on the penult, but on the final syllable? In this case, things get complicated because the nature of the vowels matters, the sonority of the vowel matters. So let's first consider the case where both the vowels are identical in nature. In this case, what we will see is that the strength of the two vowels will be quite equal, meaning that the tone will have the same influence as far as intensity and length are involved as the stress. So let's take some examples. Here you have Lulu, the word for pearl, and you see that clearly there is no difference, no obvious difference at least, between the two vowels as far as length or intensity is involved. And when you hear the word as produced by the speaker, you do not have the feeling that one of the vowels is more important as the other. I will play the sound.
Lulu, Lulu.
So clearly there is a difference with the first situation when the tone and the stress align. And what we see here is that the tone does not only have an impact on the pitch, but also has an impact on the other prosodic properties, I mean length and intensity. Other example, just to show you that it's not something that is isolated. It's the case in many situations. And when I play all the sounds, I can take this one, for instance.
Shala.
We really have the feeling that there is no clear difference between the two vowels and that the stress and tone have the same influence, in fact, on these vowels. Okay, other examples, but I won't play them once again. And it works pretty well each time you have two identical vowels. Okay, now what happens when you have two different vowels and tone is on the final? So remember that tone and stress seems to have the same power on the vowels they are associated to. So in the previous case, they were on two different vowels, so they have the same, on two identical vowels, so they have the same effect on them. In the first part of this section, tone and stress were aligned, so the syllable was very strong, very intense, very long, and the second syllable was very weak. So now, what will be the case when you have two different vowels, but stress and tone? Then in this situation, it will be the nature of the vowel that will have an impact and the sonority of the vowel, to be precise. So sonority, just to say it in a few words, the closed vowels are less sonorous than mid vowels that are less sonorous than R. So here in the example you have here, nazi, in this situation, you see that the first vowel has a stress and the second vowel has tone. But since the first vowel is a sonorous vowel, it will be much more stronger than the he.
Nazi, nazi.
But it's clear that it's not as in the first part when the tone and the stress align. Here in this case, the E, even if it's weaker than the R, still has some intensity. So there are many languages that have been documented to have a stress system that depends partly or in total by the sonority of the vowels. A famous example is Takya. In this language, you stress the rightmost syllable with the R, the more sonorous vowel. If there is no R in the word, then you select the second row with a mid vowel, A or O. And if you have none of this vowel, then you stress the rightmost syllable. So sonority is well known to have an impact on stress accent systems. And it leads some searchers such as Paul de Lassie to build a vowel sonority hierarchy that you have here. You see again that A is more sonorous than Eho and Ihu, and you have a on E that can also play a role in some languages. It's not the case in Shingazidja. And so what you see is that this effect is quite clear in Shingazidja. So here, wafu, you have again a A and a closed vowel. So the intensity and length is associated to the penult. Same form, Shenzi, which is a pejorative way to characterize an African African people. Here in this case, you have A, which is more sonorous than E, and so the penult will be strong again. And here are some other examples just to give you illustrations, like this one, for instance.
Tassi.
Once again, we hear that the penult is clearly stronger than the second. But what is interesting, and it was the whole point of what I said before, is what happens when you have the reverse order of sonority. In this case, and this is what you have here, you have stress on the penult. It's still there, in my opinion, as an analytical level. You have tone on the final syllable, but when the final syllable is has more sonority than the penult, in this situation, the final syllable will be stronger, more long, and more intense. So let me play the word so you can hear it.
Nifa, nifa, nifa.
So you see that we have a change in the way we see things here, because in all the examples we had before, we saw that the penult was important, but in this case, the tone and the vowel combine to give the final syllable more strength than the penult. So we are not in a classical situation in Bantu where the penult syllable, when stressed, is more intense and more long. In this case, you have variation depending on some parameters. That means that in the actual state of the language, you can have prominence either on the penult or the final, or as we see later on the antepenult. Here are some other examples just to show you that it's once again, it's not an apex, it's something that is regular, like nyumba for house.
Nyumbe, nyumbe.
So you can clearly hear that the ha is strong and see it on the signal in all these situations. And each time the second syllable is more sonorous, it is the case. This example show you that it will be true even if no A is involved, but mid vowels are more sonorous than the closed vowels. So in this case, you also have prominence that will be clearly more associated to the final than to the penult. Just an example.
Lise.
So what it means is that final vowels, when they are lower as far as opening is involved than the preceding one, may be associated with the highest degree of metrical prominence. And the important thing here is that it will overlook the stressed vowel on the underlying level in a way. Just to give you some additional details quickly, something which was not predicted by Kenstrowitz or De Lacy's hierarchies is the fact that there seems to be a difference depending on the fact that the vowel is fronted or backened. So here are two words that were borrowed to French, but it shows you that it's not an effect of French. So beauté, here it is.
Beauté.
You see that you have an effect on the final, but if you have the other words, order, béton.
Béton.
Yeah, it's a penult that clearly is stronger. So it gives you something that is very impressionistic. It's not something that is calculated, but of the interesting length of various elements. So for instance, stress and tone have a huge impact on the prominence of the output. A also is strong, more than A, which is a little bit stronger than O. The mid vowels are stronger than E and U, and E is a bit stronger than U. consonants can play a marginal role in this aspect. So pre-nasalized consonant strengthen the vowel. I don't know why. I have no clear explanation. I have some ideas, of course, but no clear explanation. A sonorant or H, not the other fricatives, can weaken a vowel on the, for instance. Here are some examples. So you have this word where you have two identical vowels, stress and tone. So you would expect the same level as we saw before, but it's not the case because of the presence of the pre-nasalized, which will make the final syllable a bit stronger.
Nange.
Here are some examples showing that sonorant will weaken a bit the vowel that follows. And so sometimes you have to take all these elements together to explain what happens. So for instance, soha, you have a h that will weaken the vowel. So even if you have a r, you will not have a clear difference with the penult that has a ho because of the effect of the consonant. But strangely, the fact that the word does not have an onset for one of the syllables does not seem to have an impact on the prominence. Something important here, I have almost finished this section, is the fact that prominence can shift also to the antepenult. So here, what you have is a high tone on the antepenult combined with a ha, while the stressed penult is associated with a u, so there will be a clear difference. So instead of have something like ba, ru, a with a strong u, you will have this realization.
Beru, beru.
So we clearly hear that the first syllable is way stronger than the penult, which is supposed to be stressed theoretically. So when the penult is stressed and associated with the R, the fact that you have a high tone, on the other hand, is not enough to have an impact on the sonority, on the prominence of the vowel. And so the fact that tone can be associated to various syllables means that we'll have some shifts in the position of the prominence depending on tone. So here you have an example where you have a high tone on the penult and the final vowel is a ha. So the penult, since it both have stress and tone, will be intense. But if you have the singular, there is no high tone on the prefix, so no shift on the penult. So then it will be the final R, which will have the tone and the R, which will be strong, and the penult will be lower. And so it has an impact on the way that contrasts are expressed. So for instance, if you compare these two verbal forms, you have tibaya. Here the tone is on the penult because it's the root has a high tone, and in the plural you have a high tone here, which will be clearly be expressed, and the F0 will fall afterwards. But sorry, if you have different vowels that are involved, you see that it has an impact. So Tibusu has exactly the same tonal pattern, but then when you have Ribusu, since you do not have here a strong vowel, then the F0 will not be as high as it was the case before. And in some situation, we may think that it has an impact on the opposition, and now there is a complete neutralization of the difference between singular and plural. Let's skip this. So what will be the future of Shingazidja building upon these issues? So we saw that Shingazidja has both tonal and accentual properties and post-lexical phenomena that indicate that it goes more on the second dimension than on the first. And what we just saw is that the interaction of tone stress and sonority also moves toward an accentual system, since now, since the tone has an impact on duration and intensity, and since when it applies on a low vowel, it will shift the prominence, we move towards a system that looks more like English as to a Bantu language, a classical Bantu language. So we can have an idea of the future of Shingazidja looking on other Comorian languages that have moved forward to a really a real accent systems. In fact, when you take a look at some other Comorian languages, you have the feeling that it works exactly as Shingazidja. So for instance, here in Shimaore, broad wing, you have a tone that shifts on the following syllable where it is blocked, while when the following syllable already has a high tone, it does not move. It seems it's also the same in the Shinzwani examples. But I will skip this, sorry. What is interesting is that in Shimaore, the language of Mayotte, you see in the example in 33 that when you have several words or sentence, things are simplified. And in this language, you have you will not have a shift to the following syllable or this kind of stuff. What you will have, you will only have a high tone on the antepenult. So it's really simplified. And in Shinzwani, it's also the same. Sorry. When you put together a large number of words, in this situation, you will only keep the first accent, the first tone. So the tonal situation is really reduced. So we can expect that in the future, Shingazidja will move more and more up to a point where it will be like Shinzwani or Shimaore in reducing the effect of tone progressively, and probably that in few generations, Shingazidja will be an accentual language and not a tonal language anymore. I have not discussed this fact in my presentation, but there are very few cases where you have a lexical opposition between words according to tone. And as we saw before, in all these cases, you can only have a high tone on the penult or on the final. So it will be different that will be not really tonal in the classical sense, in the articulable sense anymore. So I thank you for your attention.
Thank you. there was quite a lot of data and also an interesting system changing. Does anyone have a question to Cedric? It's interesting to see this, not mixed system, but maybe responses, prosody responses to different parts of the grammar. That's what I want to characterize. Nice it. Yeah. So when there's a sonority differences, you see certain kind of responses. When for tone, it's still there, so you need to respond to that. Now, the reason why I mentioned this is because in a language that I look at in the India, if a syllable begins with a sonority onset, like a nasal or liquid, you have a tonal contrast, like ma and ma, you get this tonal contrast. But when it starts with a minus sonorant onset, like pa or ba, then you get high tone always, and ba, you get low tone. Mm. However, that's the description, but recently we found that doesn't hold in a accentual phrase, in a phonological phrase situation, because in non-initial position, that distinction is not anymore there. So how do you describe that kind of system where you have a split by the onset consonant? So, and in Shingazidja, it's based on the sonority of the vowel. So you see this kind of effect, so.
There are papers on the impact of vowels on tones, on tone generation, but some it's the length of vowels, for instance, that will trigger a difference later in tones. But in your case, do you think it's a sonorant that triggered a split in the register, or is it the opposite, the obstruents would use previous shift in the register?
I think the tonal split already happened in the historical stage. So maybe there's a tonal simplification. At least that's what I can say at this point for the obstruent. And or maybe it's a phonetic induced fact. Given, which makes me go back to your question, your pattern. You talked about the sonority conditioning these differences. How much of that conditioning do you think, because sonority is clearly a phonological concept, like distinguishing the vowels in this way. However, sonority has phonetic reflex as well. Like usually low vowels are more sonorous, but also phonetically they tend to be longer, and they tend to be maybe more intense. Amplitude might be higher for these values. And how much of this change do you think it's a tug between phonetics and phonology in terms of trying to keep a system, or are we?
That's one. I will bet on the phonetic aspects because of the way that I cannot imagine of phonological features, for instance, could explain the difference between the difference that prenasalized consonant made, while phonetically I clearly understand how it can be expressed with a strength that is generated by the nasal part on the following part and everything. Mm-hmm. While phonologically, I don't understand how prenasalized can have an impact. And it's the same with the fact that her has a specific behavior in regard to the other fricatives. And also the difference between front and back. That's something also that is not expected with only phonology, I suppose, because it's not, I never saw any other studies that discussed the difference, an impact on the front and back on the sonority aspects like syllabification or this kind of stuff, but maybe you know.
No, I don't think I've seen it, and I don't know whether people actually even look at this issue, because many tonal languages, they're just tone, so people assume it will always be the tone that's dominant, and
You have some studies on the fact that when you look at the F0 and you look at the F2, sometimes they align in some languages.
Right,
so
you
expect this kind of, so you have an effect of, but not to the, up to this point, I mean.
Right. It's not like systematically people went through this, okay, same sonority vowel or like the sonority vowel differences, then controlling for the tone, where's the underlying tone. So there are many things to consider in order to see this effect, if there's any. So there are some food for thought that can go on. Does anyone else have a question, perhaps? So the dog is really curious about, so in the beginning of your presentation, you talked about like Gerard Philipson describing it in this way and Chuck describing it in a different way. So could it be that they were looking at actually different dialects of Shingazidja and they independently came to the conclusion based on the dialect that they were looking at?
No. I don't know exactly because I do not have the details on the speakers with whom they work. I know that Chuck work in the United States with a speaker. So
I see.
Move just as I worked in France with a speaker. So everything like this must have an impact. But I think it's more related to the way that Gerard understands what is a tone language in opposition to an action tone language, because he links this to the number of oppositions you have. So the basic idea is that if you have two tones and a disyllabic word, then you expect four possibilities, and if you go beyond the point, then you will have an action to a language. So I think, for instance, Gerard would accept that a language that has high low and low low, he will consider this as an action to a language, while somebody like Larry would refuse this. So maybe it's this that distinguish Chuck and Gerard. But that's a good question.
But also, it gives us this idea, any student in this audience, if they are interested in looking at some grammar and descriptions, we need to be, not only you, but like all of us need to be really careful about how we categorize things, how we type, what kind of type we put the language in, since the description on the surface can be an interpretation of some kind of theoretical view towards the language or like towards the data that's being imposed on.
Exactly, and that's something I think we all tend to forget sometimes. So we all tend to forget that all definition of a concept may not be shared by the audience. And of course, we cannot always define all the concepts we use. I did not define vowels or consonants, but maybe the way I consider consonants differ from yours, because it depends if we consider the underlying system, the surface systems. Maybe we can consider that we do not agree on this aspect also. So it's hard to remind that we may not discuss the same thing at the moment. It leads to fights that are no motive because, or arguments, not fights, but arguments that are not unmotivated because we are not discussing the same object.
Yep. Well, thank you. I think time is up, so we will just formally wrap up, and then any remaining discussion we can just continue. I would like to thank the two organizers of this series, Professor Tomoyuki Yoshida and Professor Yoko Mizuta, the assistants Paris Fleming, Shigeto Kamano, as well as the liaison IRS Institute assistant Michinori Suzuki. This event was supported by the shared budget of ICU Research Institute, IERS, and the Linguistic Lab at ICU. The next colloquium will be on February 5th. It's just 1 week away, and the time moves back to the 10 a.m. And we will have a phonology talk by Chris Green and a syntax talk by Oluseye Adesola from Yale University. So thank you all for coming to today's colloquium. Let's applaud. I'm going to plot to the center, and let's stop the recording.